Previously, we discussed the various political systems in South Asian region, which have produced many forms of government, like democratic, socialist, military, and monarchical. We also discussed how Bhutan, Pakistan, Maldives, and Nepal moved toward greater democracy in South Asia. But conflict continues to exist in the region. It remains prone to military interventions in politics, corruption in government, and terrorism. The tensions among the countries still exist. South Asia would remain a conflict-prone region or would emerge as a major regional bloc depends on internal politics of South Asian region. So we'll talk about relations among the South Asian countries. And now I'll discuss India's relations with Pakistan and Bangladesh. Let us first discuss India-Pakistan relations. Since the partition of British India in 1947 and creation of modern states of India and Pakistan, the relation between the two has always been full of ups and downs. Geographically, historically, and culturally, no other two states have so much in common as India and Pakistan. But despite similarities, relations are not smooth and peaceful. Unfortunately, they never became good friends and always engaged in conflicts and disputes. Now let us discuss various areas of conflicts, starting with wars fought between the two countries. First, the Kashmir War of 1947. It is the first of the four Indo-Pakistan wars. We know that during the time of partition, Jammu and Kashmir was a princely state. The British had given all princely states choice either to join India or to join Pakistan or even to remain independent. The ruler of Kashmir during that time was Maharaja Hari Singh. He was a Hindu who ruled over a majority Muslim princely state. He did not want to merge with India or Pakistan. Now, why is Kashmir so important? It is important for both India and Pakistan because of its strategic location on the borders of India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and China. Pakistan insisted that the Muslim majority state should join Pakistan. The Maharaja faced an uprising in Poonch and lost control of the western districts. In October 1947, Pakistan's Pashtun tribal forces crossed the border of the state. Maharaja Hari Singh requested India for assistance. India offered help in return to his signing an instrument of accession to India. The Maharaja signed it and Indian troops were sent. The war officially ended on January 1, 1949, when the United Nations arranged a ceasefire, meaning a truce between the two countries. However, it resulted in India securing two-thirds of Kashmir, including Kashmir Valley, Jammu, and Ladakh. Pakistan controls roughly one-third of the state referred to as Azad Kashmir. India referred the dispute to the United Nations Security Council on January 1, 1948. The United Nations resolution, though not binding on India and Pakistan, clearly said that Pakistan is the aggressor and has to vacate all occupied territory in the state and hand it over to India. And India has to remove all its forces, leaving aside enough to maintain law and order, and conduct a plebiscite in the state. Plebiscite means direct vote of the people expressing their will. So far, India has not conducted plebiscite as nearly one-third of the state of Jammu and Kashmir is still under Pakistan. Now let us discuss India-Pakistan War of 1965, which came to be known as the Second Kashmir War. The war began after the failure of Pakistan's Operation Gibraltar, which was designed to infiltrate and invade Jammu and Kashmir and start a rebellion against Indian rule. Pakistan thought that it would gain control over Kashmir if the operation was successful. But the operation resulted in a major failure. India had suffered a defeat at the hands of China in 1962, and Pakistan thought that the Indian army would not be able to defend Kashmir. The international border, that is the Red Cliff Line, was crossed by India on September 6, which marked the official beginning of the war. The war ended on September 23, 1965, after the United Nations Security Council called for an unconditional ceasefire. The war was a victory for India, even though Pakistan claims otherwise. Their claim of liberating Kashmir did not succeed. Due to the mediation of Soviet Union in 1966, both the countries signed a peace treaty known as the Tashkent Agreement, in which they agreed to return conquered territories, remove troops, and return to the borders established in 1949. The signatories to this agreement were Indian Prime Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri and Pakistani President Ayub Khan. Now, Indo-Pakistan War of 1971. This was the first war between the countries that did not involve fighting over the Kashmir. East Pakistan, that is present Bangladesh, felt exploited by West Pakistan. The 1971 war started when Pakistan launched airstrikes on 11 Indian air bases. It lasted for 13 days, after which Pakistan surrendered. Bangladesh emerged as an independent country. India declared a unilateral ceasefire, and later the Shimla Agreement was signed by Indira Gandhi and Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, bringing back the peace between the two nations. The Shimla Agreement contains a set of guiding principles, and these guiding principles emphasize, first, respect for each other's territorial integrity and sovereignty, second, non-interference in each other's internal affairs, third, respect for each other's unity and political independence, fourth, sovereign equality and giving up hostile propaganda. Now, the Kargil conflict of 1999. Indian Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee travelled by bus to Lahore to meet Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif in 1999. The two signed the Lahore Declaration, the first major agreement between the two countries since the Shimla Agreement. Both countries restated that they remained committed to the Shimla Agreement and agreed to undertake a number of confidence-building measures to improve bilateral relations. Confidence-building measures means steps taken to exchange information and decrease misunderstanding. However, in May 1999, the Kargil conflict broke out. Pakistani soldiers disguised as Kashmiri militants crossed the line of control and occupied strategic positions of the Indian side, which were vacated by Indian Army during winters. In a counter-Indian attack, Pakistani forces were pushed back to their side of the original line of control. It was the first armed conflict between the two neighbors since they officially conducted nuclear weapons tests. Now let us discuss the various areas of conflicts other than wars. Kashmir remains an area of conflict. It is divided between the two countries by the line of control. The glaciers provide fresh water, and the water that flows through Kashmir provides electricity in India. Pakistan also relies heavily on glacial waters for its agricultural sector. Moreover, Kashmir is a major national security issue for both the nations. The control of Kashmir could pose a threat to the very existence of the other. The other disputed area is Siachen Glacier, which is located in northern Ladakh. Before 1984, neither of the two countries had any permanent presence on the glacier. Under the Shimla Agreement, Siachen was called a barren and useless, that is, a lifeless area. The agreement also did not specify the boundary between India and Pakistan. When India got intelligence that Pakistan was going to occupy Siachen Glacier, it launched Operation Meghdoot to reach the glacier first. The operation was successful. The Indian Army obtained the area at a higher altitude. Thus, India has a strategic advantage. After the 2003 peace treaty, firing and bombardment have stopped in this area, though both sides have stationed their armies in this region. Sir Creek is a 96 kilometers long delta in the Run of Kutch, where Arabian Sea joins the landmass. It currently lies on the border of India's Gujarat and Pakistan's Sindh province. At the time of partition, boundary here was not demarcated, and since then, Pakistan has claimed the entire area. According to international law, a boundary can only be fixed in the middle of the navigable channel, which meant that it has to be divided between India and Pakistan. India has used this clause of international law to argue that the boundary needs to be fixed in the middle of the creek. Both the countries continue to claim the disputed area. If one country agrees to the other's position, then the other will lose a vast amount of exclusive economic zone. This area is quite rich with gas and mineral deposits. The water dispute between Pakistan and India began during the early 1960s. However, the Indus Water Treaty, negotiated by the World Bank, created an understanding of how water between the two countries would be shared. There are six rivers, and this treaty divided three rivers for use by each country. During the 1990s, India constructed a hydroelectric plant along Chenab River. Pakistan says that it violates the treaty and will impact its water supply. Other major issues of conflict are cross-border terrorism and violation of ceasefire at border. Armed insurgency in the Kashmir began in 1989. That is, violent rebellion against the government started in the Kashmir Valley. Islamic terrorist groups like the Lashkar-e-Taiba, Hizbul Mujahideen continued to be active in Jammu and Kashmir in 1990s. In July 2001, Pakistani President Pervez Musharraf and Indian Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee met for a two-day summit in Agra. However, both sides were unable to reach an agreement on the issue of Kashmir. Then in December in the same year, Indian Parliament was attacked by terrorists linked with Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Taiba. 14 people were killed in the attack. In 2008, armed gunmen opened fire on civilians at several sites in Mumbai. Ajmal Kasab was the only attacker who was captured alive, and he said that the attackers were members of Lashkar-e-Taiba. In the wake of the attacks, India broke off talks with Pakistan. Once again, terrorists disguised as soldiers carried out deadly attacks on Pathankot Air Base and on Army Base in Uri. India launched surgical strikes on terrorist units in Pakistan-administered Kashmir, and in 2019 also conducted air attacks against Pakistan-based Jaish-e-Mohammed's biggest training camp. And in this air attack, a very large number of terrorists were killed. The 2019 Pulwama attack was the starting point of the steep decline in relations. The removal of Article 370 and 35A further obstructed the bilateral ties. Since partition, India and Pakistan have signed many agreements to generate confidence and reduce tensions. Some military and non-military confidence building measures were taken. However, any progress made at the political front has often led to a terror attack or ceasefire violation because of Pakistan military's dominance. Pakistan's military dictates its foreign policy. Now let us discuss how relations between the two countries can be improved. The chances of conducting meaningful talks between the two nations are very less. And the best that can happen is that the diplomatic relations are fully restored. Pakistan's political structure also needs to be reformed. Despite the democratic elections, the military holds the real power in the country. It is highly difficult for India to undertake diplomatic relations with Pakistani government because it is not the decision maker. The decisions are made by the military. The problems of terrorism and non-state actors need to be addressed jointly. The terrorist attacks in India were planned by non-state actors, that is, various militant organizations which breed and nurture in Pakistan. Through attacks, these non-state actors demonstrate their ability to dictate bilateral engagements between the two countries. Pakistan must take responsibilities for the activities of these non-state actors. Propaganda on both sides to justify each other's stand on conflicting issues is also a major concern. This is creating misconception and hatred among the people of both countries. So steps must be taken to facilitate travel between the two countries or organize events to promote the bilateral ties. Steps should also be taken to improve bilateral trade. South Asia has quite a lot of potential, but still it has not progressed. And this is mostly because of the differences and tensions between India and Pakistan. If India and Pakistan improves their relations, then any threat faced by South Asia can easily be addressed. Peace and stability are also very important for economic development. We can establish a peaceful and prosperous South Asia only through building trust and increasing cooperation among the member nations. Now let us discuss India-Bangladesh relations. India was the first country to recognize Bangladesh as a separate and independent state and established diplomatic relations with Bangladesh immediately after its independence in December 1971. Both the countries have a shared history and common heritage, linguistic and cultural ties, and passion for music, literature, and the arts. In the last couple of years, the relationship has been further strengthened. In 1972, the 25-year friendship treaty was signed between India and Bangladesh. But assassination of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, followed by military dictatorship, and in 1980s, Bangladesh's emphasis on Islam created tensions between the two countries. Bangladesh is quite important for India. Its location is a strategic block between mainland India and northeastern seven states. Now look at the map and let's find out how important Bangladesh is. Each of the northeastern states is landlocked and has a shorter route to the sea through Bangladesh. The nearest port for the northeast is Kolkata. Kolkata is 1500 kilometers from Aizwal and Agartala. The problem is not only the distance, but also the route. The route passes through multiple states and through a lot of mountains. This also makes trade very hard in Northeast. Every product that is either produced in Northeast or needed in Northeast has to be carried through one road, and that is through Siliguri. On the other hand, Bangladeshi port is just 200 kilometers from Tripura, and a major Bangladeshi railway junction is just 10 kilometers from Agartala. India has been requesting Bangladesh to provide rail and road passage to connect with its northeastern states. Technically speaking, the issue of passage was resolved in 1972 when both sides agreed to mutually use their waterways, railways, and roadways for commerce. Inland water transit has been functional, but the rail and road transit are still waiting to be operational. Bangladesh is reluctant to grant India rail and road transit because it believes that it may encourage terrorism and insurgency, and also the increased traffic flow from Indian side would damage roads and bridges in Bangladesh. In September 2018, Prime Minister of both the countries, Narendra Modi and Sheikh Hasina, inaugurated a rail project. This will give further push to India's Act East policy by connecting northeastern states with Southeast Asia. Look East policy, which we have already discussed earlier, was launched by former Prime Minister Narasimha Rao in order to recover from the loss of the strategic partner, that is USSR, after the end of the Cold War. India tried to build up a relationship with the USA and its allies in Southeast Asia. India Act East policy was launched by Narendra Modi at the 12th ASEAN-India Summit in 2014. Act East policy focused on ASEAN countries, plus economic integration, plus East Asian countries, and security cooperation. So, Bangladesh can act as a bridge to economic and political linkages with Southeast Asia and beyond. Good relations would also ensure that no anti-India activities are carried out from its soil. Now let us discuss the areas of cooperation between the two. India and Bangladesh share about 4,000 kilometers of border. Now once again, let us look at the maps and understand the border issue and steps taken to resolve it. The Teen Biga is a strip of land lying in West Bengal state. Geographically, it is surrounded by Indian territory in north and south, but by Bangladeshi area on east and west. It is located between the Bangladesh enclaves. Enclave means any portion of a country that is entirely surrounded by territory of another nation, meaning Indian territory inside Bangladesh territory or Bangladesh territory within Indian territory. The land boundary agreement was signed in 1974 between Indira Gandhi and Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, which provided for the exchange of enclaves. The Teen Biga corridor was to be handed over to Bangladesh in 1974 itself, that is after the signing of the agreement. While Bangladesh handed over the said areas right away, but Teen Biga could not be handed over to the Bangladesh because it needed a constitutional amendment. This delayed the process. And in 1992, the area was leased to Bangladesh, meaning the area was opened up, people of the enclave were able to move through the corridor and access their mainland. In 2011, the corridor was opened for 24 hours. However, there were protests within India. The 50,000 people in enclaves were stateless and suffered restrictions on movement as they did not possess passports. They also lacked healthcare and schools, and they were not even allowed to vote in elections. However, in 2015, India ratified the 1974 Land Boundary Treaty. The constitution was amended and the historic agreement allowed the exchange of enclaves by India and Bangladesh. After nearly 70 years of statelessness, more than 50,000 people will now receive citizenship and all its benefits. The second area of cooperation is sharing river water. India and Bangladesh share 54 common rivers. In 1996, the sharing of the Ganga waters was successfully agreed upon between the two nations. A bilateral joint rivers commission has been working since June 1972 to maximize benefits for common river systems. India and Bangladesh share the historical legacy of cooperation and support during the Liberation War of 1971. And even today, various joint exercises of army and navy take place between the two countries. Over the last decade, bilateral trade between India and Bangladesh has grown. Bangladesh is India's biggest trade partner in South Asia. India has extended a $2 billion line of credit to Bangladesh and 20 other agreements, including bus services, shipping, and trade have also been signed. Such help in infrastructural development will further help to strengthen bilateral ties. India has also stood by Bangladesh in its hour of need. aid worth over $37 million was provided to help Bangladesh when it was coping with its natural disasters and floods in 2007 and 8. Bangladesh has long suffered from severe electricity shortages. Reliance Power and Adani, two Indian energy companies, signed agreements with Bangladesh state-run electricity agency to invest in its power sector. The deals involve the construction of 4 natural gas plants and 2 coal-fired facilities to produce more power. Bangladesh is currently importing power from India. Now let us discuss areas of tensions between the two countries. The flow of migrants across the Bangladesh border due to unstable conditions in Bangladesh has caused serious socio-economic and political problems, especially for the people of Indian states bordering Bangladesh. Moreover, the management of borders is not easy. The border is used as a route for smuggling livestock, food items, medicines, and drugs from India to Bangladesh. The border has also witnessed conflicts between the border security forces of India and the border guards of Bangladesh. And now India has decided to construct a road along the 2,200-kilometer Indo-Bangladesh border to check infiltration of unauthorized persons into India. Border tensions between India and Bangladesh are not new. The non-demarcation of a 6.5-kilometer land border along Tripura makes the border question unresolved. India is reluctant to resolve this issue because of the concern that Hindus living in the area are likely to go to Bangladesh after demarcation. Bangladesh also uses China card to bargain with India. Currently, Bangladesh is an active partner of the Belt and Road Initiative, which we have already discussed. And because of this, Chinese funding for infrastructure development has increased in Bangladesh. Since 2015, China has emerged as Bangladesh's top trading partner. It has displaced India from its position. Bangladesh is the second biggest importer of Chinese weaponry from Pakistan. The delivery of 2 Chinese submarines to Bangladesh in 2017 has raised concerns in India. Another major concern is sharing water from the river Tista. It is the 4th longest river shared by India and Bangladesh. From December to March, the water level reduces in Tista, and because of this, Bangladeshis face water shortage. In 2011, India and Bangladesh finalized an agreement, and by this agreement, India would get about 42% and Bangladesh about 37% water of the river. However, Bangladesh wants more share in water. In 1996, the sharing of the Ganga waters was successfully agreed upon between the two nations. But the major area of dispute has been India's construction and operation of the Faraka barrage to increase water supply to the river Hooghly. Bangladesh complains that it does not get a fair share of the water in the dry season, and some of its areas get flooded when India releases excess waters during the monsoons. Insurgency has also contributed in creating tensions. The question of ISI operating from Bangladesh and supporting the insurgents in the northeast is one of the major issues. The National Register of Citizens has been prepared to identify genuine Indian citizens living in Assam since 1971 or earlier. It is to identify illegal migrants, and the majority of which are Bangladeshi. This concerns Bangladesh because the excluded people will be returned back to Bangladesh and will cause a rehabilitation issue there. Bangladesh Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina's visit to India in October 2019 was a positive step in the relationship between India and Bangladesh. The agreement to supply gas to Tripura and the use of Bangladeshi ports to serve the northeastern states is a result of the goodwill between the two countries. The agreement for a skill development center in Bangladesh to train the youth is another example of strong ties. In 2019, India has agreed to train Bangladeshi bureaucrats. The areas of concerns must be dealt through friendship and collaborations. India's regional interests compel it to maintain strong relations with Bangladesh. India needs to maintain dialogue with Bangladesh and avoid any potential fallout.